Okay, thank you. So the initiative for this presentation is to show not exactly the complete evolution of these two projects, but to focus mainly on the adobe masonry. Though, as it is in the end now of this session, I will perhaps skip some things that already have been said, and maybe I will also do some general remarks, at least like some things that also I found very relative from the previous spokesman. Okay, generally, we know that in Greece we have these two contradictory realities in one sense, that although we are more and more interested in the experimentation with earth materials and natural materials, on the other side, what we have here in Greece is only adobe, and these adobe masonry buildings, at least, they are generally neglected, or when somebody is repairing something, because they have to, some people that are just living there, they just do it in an improvised way, usually not in a proper way. So, one hand, we have this new knowledge that we have somehow accomplished right now with various scattered projects that, okay, you have also seen of what is being done in Greece. But on the other hand, we have this devaluation that is constant of the historic buildings. So although in the two projects that we have made, the new constructions, it was not only about adobe, but I wanted to link the adobe of the new soil mix, as we said, with the old problem of repairing the buildings, although we have also each one of the two engineers practiced as well with other techniques, like I did some rammed earth as well in my project, and Kostas, the other engineer, did also more like surface finishes with earth plasters or some tadellact. So for both of us, anyway, it was an experimentation, but the important thing is that we did it kind of ad hoc and on our own interpretation of what can be done with the traditional techniques or the innovative techniques. So generally, Mark, is that, okay, we know that it was used in Greece, but old users and new users, for some reason, have hardly met somewhere in these 10 years, more or less, of natural building. Okay, the results of this have been shown already. So, okay, there were some questions that they kept on rising, how you can combine new experimental construction and the needs for repair for Greek adobe built heritage. Is it a case, perhaps, to my opinion, then we will also show it in the presentation, that major landmarks, perhaps it's a good case study to focus, so to see really what can be done and what we don't know yet. It's definitely that we have some gaps of knowledge, and I think that from an engineering point of view, it's important to make some distinctions. For example, we can say, a lot of us that we, like as with people that have already spoken, that I use adobe or I use the other technique, but I think there's also a distinction on the structural function. It's another thing to make an adobe masonry for a bench or when you build an urban space. It's very nice, it can be very user participatory and community-based approach is really great, and there were great examples that were shown, at least I very much liked it. It's a different story when it comes to walls of housing, for example. So, although it's the same material, in the end it's not exactly the same. Also, the way that we use it here in Greece, traditionally, but as well as now when we try contemporary constructions, we do basically a composite system. We have these horizontal laces of timber, like staircases horizontally, and we have also these timber frames, and they're all kind of combined. So when we're talking about infill masonry, we are kind of diminishing the authentic role of this masonry. Like, in reality, it was a bearing structure. We cannot reproduce it now. Nowadays, we are kind of hesitant to risk this thing in the existing requirements of the society. So then we have already an issue. And on the other hand, we say that it's infill masonry basically to get a permit from the urban office. It's a trick because it's a simplification. It's not really a trick, but it's not an infill masonry in the sense that wattle and daub or other kinsha or other techniques, light clay techniques, can be really infill. We cannot really have it as panels. Of course, you can do whatever you want. It's not. But from an engineering point of view, these things matter. These are the gaps of knowledge that we found also during practice. So that's really the purpose. Okay, this has already been said, I think, these relationships that we all try to find. And I will just briefly say some things about how these two case studies were common. We started, of course, with the reinforced concrete foundations, and both of us, the engineers, were not directly linked. We were just friends, so we were exchanging opinions. So the first project that I will show you, both projects had these features, like a timber frame. Okay, we chose the same wall thickness, we chose a bond that was very important, the same brick dimensions. We had to produce the adobe bricks on site. And of course, these were projects that were self-funded for self-use. It was practically my house, my family house in the country, and the other persons, the other engineers, also the family house in another place. So we both had to, you know, work all aspects together, from design to really the actual implementation, the hands-on production. We were involved in all the stages. So briefly, we can see that these projects were kind of far from each other, but also far from ourselves that we were doing this. There are two different regions of Greece with different culture of relation to the earth building culture. The Trikala region, as was also presented from the previous presentation, is much more evident that you have this culture. In my region, it's semi-mountainous part of Peloponnese, is not so evident. It's mostly hidden under plasters. You have to look for it to find it. But the older people in the villages, of course, they knew it was for them. When I started doing this work, oh, okay, they knew about it, but they couldn't say anything about it. So what was also different, and I think it makes generally a difference, for just adobe masonry, is that you have to make some worksite organization. You have too many phases that the plot of the land may play some role of how you organize the works. And also, of course, there are some differentiations that me and the other engineers had in our procedures. For example, I was sieving and mixing dry the mix before putting it in the mixer and making a wet mix. Like, for example, in Trikala, it was much more like a vast land, and there were a lot more, like, I mean, a flat land, more abundant space, and they were laying the bricks, for example, directly on the field. That was proved to be not so easy then for building, for the mason, to work with that. So I took this lesson from the other project that was the pioneer project, the beginning. And I had it on a slab, on a shaded space, the curing of the adobe. Like just to illustrate the sequence, one was mixing on foot, a wet mix. We were mixing it on the mixer. They were just laying the adobe bricks. We were doing a hand press. The curing process in the Megalopoli case was more controlled. In the end, the result, it was not really measured because, okay, both of us were very involved in all these aspects of construction, and me, for example, I even forgot about doing simple things, like I could have at least measured the density of this or the weight of this masonry units. So everything that we have, like the small details that we have differentiated and we were discussing about it, we still had the question of how important really they were in the actual result of the construction, of the quality of the construction. This is also an issue for the traditional construction. It's nice to just put it all together as adobe, but is it important or not to analyze the soil mixes? Can we really know that there were some differences of production in each area of Greece? So these links between what was the initial technique and what is what we interpret now, perhaps has some importance or not in the actual result. But what you can get out of these projects, I think, was that we should approach this technique, the adobe masonry, more as a structural component, not just the material itself, again, for buildings, for houses. Because I don't think that there are a lot of ways that you can really make a big difference on the brick itself by just adding some magic additive or just doing something really correctly in any, let's say, industrialized or laboratory conditions. But what is more important, I think, was the workmanship. So, like in this image, we can see that sometimes you have difficulty when you try to accommodate the adobe bricks on pediments. Or, for example, there is another restriction that we usually have, and it was shown also in other presentations. Because of the structural analysis of these timber frames, as we ignore the influence of the masonry, we have to ignore it completely. So we put this diagonal bracing. Once you put this diagonal bracing on some openings, you basically completely break the bond that you expect to make in an adobe wall. The adobe wall is not like a stone masonry wall. Although it has resemblances, you still, I think you should consider it as a whole. It will behave as a whole. And if there is something to be improved, it's on the wall level. So, of course, the traditional aspects of the timber laces were important, how you can combine them. You try to do whatever you can better. I would advise, okay, that was also my approach, that in this kind of senas that you make with the horizontal ladders, you could also alter the mix a little bit there. You can make it more like a poured earth, like with more aggregates or something. Generally, the important, I think, difference in the end was like to put this ring beam, but really with a bedding surface, as you can see on the third image, like here, that is really putting some axial compression on the whole wall. So the out-of-plane action that you think that it's weak, the weakness of this masonry, is diminished. Like the deformability and the eccentricity of the masonry is less. And again, the last one was this application of the plaster. We used the lime plasters to be compatible, and also Kostas used some earth plaster experiments, but we were still not so confident about plasters anyway, so we kept it like that. But what I did as an extra measure was to give this confinement, as it was taken as an idea from Peru, mostly, that they had, but also perhaps other places in Latin America, using the geotextiles or generally wrapping up the whole surface of the masonry. Because again, it's not only a matter of collapse. Okay, you will avoid collapse, obviously, because you have not put any confidence in this masonry, in the new constructions. You make it like a panel. Okay, but still, this panel has a lot of effort to make because of the previous workside considerations and all that. So you don't really afford structural failures like out of nothing. You should try to have some quality control. So these are concerns that you start to make, to have. I'm sure like others have experienced it when it comes to a project that is not a workshop. It's not something that, okay, we do just to experience the material. It's something that we kind of invested on that. So you need, you know, something more about it. So very briefly, we can see some comparative parameters of that. So apart from this ring beam that I thought that was the good point to focus, to enhance the behavior of the wall, and also these horizontal laces that perhaps they have to be in a certain spacing, that's still a question mark. What spacing is adequate to have the horizontal laces? It's not derived directly from tradition. We cannot really know, or at least I don't know, any study that has done something more particular of a survey of a building, of, or at least of a statistical amount of buildings, to know that, you see, these buildings have this kind of spacing for horizontal ladders, for example. But another thing that I think it was good to put there was the workmanship of the mortar, for like the pointing of the mortars, and especially the vertical joints, they have to be elaborated. It's good also, I think, to put some extra additives, if possible, at least in the mortar. That was an experience that we have from restoration of stone remains, of usually prehistoric remains. I didn't put any pictures of that because, okay, I didn't know that there was so much focus already on this that I'm talking, so I missed it. So I could briefly say that in Greece, we use a lot soil-based floors when we are restoring an open archaeological site, because initially the floors were earth floors. So we reproduce the original levels of floors, even when you have an archaeological site that it's only ground plans of low height walls that it has been left there. We usually put the levels with the soil-based mix, and we also have soil-based mortars to repair so that we have a compatibility, but also compatibility and repair goes always with some upgrade, because you don't have the initial construction and you imitate it. You have a construction that has been deteriorated and you try to put it in a level that is respectable of the initial structure, but also adequate, structurally adequate. So yes, then a suggestion in this case was lime and pozzolan, like a light percentage of it to stabilize the mix, and then of course to do some tests on site to see cracking and plasticity and all that. So, okay, these were also mentioned about the wall system problems and the bed joints and how compatible you can make the mortar. And then it's some questions that were left for us unanswered, because, again, in Greece so far, most of these projects are kind of one-off ventures. Like, you try once, you do your best or what you could, but it takes some time to link it with another experience. So in the end, if something was better done or not, does it? What kind of difference does it make? Should I really try to put my effort in one aspect or another? For example, okay, I will go back a bit. I was very satisfied, you can see in this picture, of the result of the adobe bricks. They were very solid, homogeneous. This cut is a clear cut with a wheel, an electric wheel, to cut it. But okay, I don't know if that was really that important anyway. It just satisfied me because it was our effort. So, yeah, these are questions like about the quality control and then some minimum requirements. It's not always about very complex mathematics. It should also be some qualitative but also quantitative balance of the experience, that it becomes a transferable knowledge somehow. Like, why we need this transferable knowledge? I don't think we need it so much on the present market that, okay, one is doing such a project, the other can do something else. There's a kind of more free interpretation or innovation. But I think the most important thing is that we do something more like to organize this knowledge so that we can do something for the heritage of adobe masonry buildings. Because, okay, what I had as a personal conclusion from what were the other presentation is that if I had now to make a new contemporary building, I wouldn't choose adobe masonry. I can very nicely choose any light clay or waterland dab and straw bale, really as an insulating material, make all the nice surfaces that I want with earth plasters, and okay, go on. I mean, make my architectural design, like at least for architects. Okay, engineers, they have to come when it's a boring thing, like something really like difficulty, and try to find something about. The boring thing is that we identify problems first, so hopefully we end up with some solutions. So for all this, I just want to complete the presentation with an example. Not to use it, but I wouldn't, like my conclusion was like that I would find it more confident and fair, let's say, to just keep it as an insulating material, the earth material, so I can use straw bale. I found it more interesting in the end to put canes or any light material rather than the adobe material, the adobe masonry for houses that have these difficulties that I encountered. And they are still unanswered because we don't have enough engineering data to combine with the worksite practice. So let's say, for example, why not to use adobe or what we don't know about adobe. Let's say that this is, I consider it one of the nicest buildings that I have seen in Peloponnese. Not that nicest is the most important, but at least from nice you can go further. And okay, it was just an occasional and let's say like a hobby. We made some measurements of this building that me and a friend, they were passing by there, and yeah, okay, people have strange hobbies, so yeah, so we measured a bit the building, and now I can really say a bit more about it. That is conveniently located next to Corinthos, which is a secondary city of Greece, but very well linked with Athens, in a nice landscape on a road trip from Athens that you go take a provincial road. And it's also close to this hamlet, very close, and also to this more big village. And I will explain why this hamlet was kind of important. And okay, this is the building. Like you have typically some stone foundation. I don't know until which level. Perhaps here you still had on the corners some corner stones or not. It's just, you know, a very brief from outside assessment. You can see the heights more or less. You can also see that they have these light walls on the back. And what about the hamlet that was next to it? Amazingly, it's really hidden from the main road, but it's all about adobe bricks there. You just had something like a farming community, I don't know, but it's left almost intact with, okay, most of the houses that are there. Okay, I said half, but it's like a rough way to accommodate this impression. And you see that you have some positive potentials. It's not like a derelict building and how I should start. It's almost intact, this building. It has this good location, well linked as it was shown. Perhaps you have a potential use that it could be commercially feasible because, okay, people that know Greek, they could see that it was a cafenion, it was a cafe for some sort. So even if you make a guest house with a cafe outside, downstairs, it's already something that you can, you know, have in mind. And then you also have this Bekianica hamlet next to it, that it's almost like an exhibition, an open-air exhibition of earthen structures. So, again, deriving some confidence from what we have done in contemporary new constructions, you could say, okay, repointing, I can do. I have some experience now with earth mortars and some joints. I know how important it is. I can say, okay, this will really help. Of course, I can replace this render that it's obviously, not really compatible and breaking down, not helping the masonry to breathe, etc., with some compatible plaster. And also, I may suggest the mesh reinforcement that I showed previously. But what about the timber bracing of this masonry, the original one? Is it enough? Will somebody be confident that, okay, yes, we can use it as it is, as a building? And more importantly, all the buildings like of this size and of this period, you have always an issue to make a good roof for this. Structurally, you need the roof as a diaphragm. This diaphragm is the same function, the same mechanism that I was showing with my timber pressing the top of the walls. If you make it like we do on a stone masonry restoration, you should put a concrete beam on top and anchor it with rods, with steel rods, on the body of the masonry. But a steel rod on this kind of earth blocks, how it will be anchored. Anchoring, generally, it's a very important feature for all the detailing that we have in these repairs. I have seen in various building codes, or not really codes, but guidelines that exist for adobe buildings, that they very much use kind of reinforcements with rebars. I would say that I'm not convinced that the rebars can really work together, cooperate with the masonry. And perhaps it could be a way to have that in a new construction. But what about when you really have to make this load transfer detailing that really holds the walls in place? So I don't know how ready we are for that. If I was commissioned this work tomorrow, I would be very stressed. And it would be a pity, because this is, I think, a challenge that we should undertake. Okay, if we care, I mean, for adobe masonry, again, for new and contemporary forms, we can do a lot of other things. So, okay, that's it. And if you wanted more to see more about it, there was a video that it was also with English subtitles that I was more or less showing the experience as an adventure in construction, like something that is not only the playful part that we, of course, all of us want to stress, that it's so nice for people to get close to the land and to the material. But okay, I think I wanted to add this, let's say, raw reality kind of aspect that especially adobe building in Greece, let's say, to make it more specific, has to have this commitment and to an adventure. Like to me, I don't know if I have surpassed the time very much, or it's more like, let's say, mountain, the difference between rock climbing and a walk in the woods. Like, or a walk in the woods can be another technique that is not so much labor intensive. The adobe curing, and like, it's not only just making the adobe. Then you have to take care of it for a long time and stock it and put it back and forth and whatever until you are able to use it. You should be more ready for that. And also, now that there are some years that have passed from this project, it's already 3 years that on one hand, I very much enjoy this house. It's my house. I like to go every time there. I touch the wall. I left it unplastered as a lunatic. But on the other hand, I feel it more like a rock climbing, that you lose the touch if you don't do it. It's not like biking. Another technique or something less could be more like biking. This one is more like rock climbing. Okay, perhaps it's irrelevant for you, but very relevant for me, as I did all of this of myself. So, anyway, that's it, and thank you.